Thank you, Dr. Samarage. Good afternoon, colleagues. I am going to discuss the topic of forensic medicine as a postgraduate subject in Sri Lanka. And I think the lecture I am giving now will be useful for you to decide when you are thinking of your postgraduate subject. The first slide, please. Can I have the first slide, please? Yes, so this is on career guidance. And the subject forensic medicine deals with the application of principles of medicine, medical knowledge and expertise to the processes of law to assist in the administration of justice. So the main aim of practicing forensic medicine by all of us is to assist in the administration of justice in the courts. All forensic knowledge, all medical knowledge and expertise. The name forensic comes from the word forensis, meaning of or before the forum. The forum was the name given to the Roman marketplace in early parts of the century. This was where a criminal case is presented before a group of public individuals who will act as judges. So the judgment in a case is given by this group of public individuals in the Roman marketplace. Next slide, please. In the Roman marketplace, both the person accused of a crime and the accuser would give speeches based on their sides of the story. The individual with the best argument and delivery would determine the outcome of the case. Someone to the today's lawyers from the prosecution and lawyers from the defense argue the case in front of a court, and depending on the evidence, the judge gives the verdict. So in olden days, in the Roman marketplace, the forum, the public or the senior citizens decided who is going to win the case based on the best argument and the delivery. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yes. Now, forensic medicine has many branches or subspecialties. Some of them are forensic pathology, clinical forensic medicine, forensic toxicology, forensic genetics, forensic entomology, forensic anthropology, forensic odontology, etc. Now, forensic pathology is what we do daily in our medical legal work, that is doing postmortems and try to determine a cause of death or cause of injury. In clinical forensic medicine, we examine live patients, patients who suffered injuries, patients with sexual offenses, patients after drunkenness, and we have to report to the police and courts. In forensic toxicology, as the name implies, it is dealing with poisoning and poisons. In forensic genetics, today a very important field, we discuss the DNA and the DNA findings to determine certain types of cases. Forensic entomology is the studying of insects, which are relevant in some cases of forensic practice. And forensic anthropology is discussing the bone architecture and deciding the types of injuries and the age of the injuries by studying bones. In forensic odontology, we study the teeth. They play a very important role in some cases of forensic medicine. The aging of a person, the injuries on a person can be determined by examining teeth. So this is not the end of the forensic medicine subspecialties, but the main ones. Next slide, please. The main role of the medical officer in forensic medicine is to assist in the corroboration of other evidence by giving factual evidence as well as expressing an opinion on the given fact. Now the term corroboration, I'll explain, that is to give evidence or information that supports what someone says. So when a doctor or forensic expert gives evidence, he has to either support what a lay witness has stated or say what the lay witness stated was wrong. So the forensic pathologist can give factual evidence, that is facts, and he has the ability and permission of the courts to give opinions, which normally witnesses don't have. When a person gives evidence in courts, he has to give facts, not opinions. But forensic experts can give opinions based on the facts presented in a case. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yes. Now, in the living, the forensic experts examine victims and assailants of crime and patients following accidental injuries, road traffic accidents, self-inflicted injuries, industrial injuries, sexual assault, child abuse, domestic violence, torture, examination of drunkenness, and examination for age discrimination. So doctors will have to examine and give reports to the police. And they have to give evidence in courts, both documentary and oral evidence. They can produce the medical reports to the courts as part of evidence. Sometimes, after giving the documentary report, they have to verbally go to the courts and give evidence. Next slide, please. In the dead, as a medical officer in hospital or as a general practitioner, the commonest thing doctors do is to declaring the medical cause of death of a person. When a patient dies in your ward or patient dies at home whom you have treated, to certify the death, the doctor will have to give a declaration of death, giving the medical cause of death, whether it's myocardial infarction, bronchopneumonia, or cirrhosis of the liver. As a forensic pathologist, you have to perform an autopsy or post-mortem examination and also visit a scene of crime. So that is a very important role played by us. We visit the scene of crime to gather evidence for the police and the courts in their analysis. Next slide, please. In certain deaths, the medical officer would be requested by the inquiry into sudden deaths to conduct a post-mortem examination to determine the cause of death. Postmortem examinations conducted at the request of inquirer into sudden death or a magistrate are referred to as medical legal or judicial postmortem examinations. They are done at the request of an inquirer or a magistrate. Next slide, please. So giving evidence in courts, I mentioned to you, is a very important role as a form of document evidence or oral evidence. Usually in the high courts, they take oral evidence. And medical officer, as I mentioned, use factual evidence and also expresses an opinion on these facts. In addition, we have to give evidence in other fora, such as court-martial held by the army or commissions of inquiry appointed by the government to inquire into important cases where the government has appointed a commission of inquiry. Next slide, please. So in the dead, I told you, visiting a scene of crime is important and the police will request you or the inquirer will request you to visit the scene of crime before removing the body to the mortuary. Next slide, please. Then I told you we are asked to do postmortems, autopsies. Why do we do postmortems, autopsies? To make a positive identification of the body, to assess sex, physique, nourishment, etc., to determine the mode of dying and the cause of death, to determine the time of death where necessary and possible, to demonstrate and record all external and internal abnormalities, malformations, and diseases, to detect, measure, and describe any external and internal done autopsies. Next slide, please. And at the postmortem, we retain relevant organs, tissues as evidence and for teaching purposes with the permission of the inquiry into subjects of the magistrate. And we also obtain photographs and video films for evidential and teaching use. As students, you may have seen when forensic medicine was taught to you, the doctors always show you the photographs of the cases they did. So these are taken at the autopsies. Next slide, please. So a doctor has to provide a full written report of the autopsy findings for court purposes and for compensation and insurance purposes. He has to offer an expert interpretation of those findings to court to give evidence. And he has to provide information to the relatives and doctors who treated the patient, because they are keen to find out why did their treatment fail or why did the patient did not respond to their treatment. And the relatives will also would like to know how the person had died. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So people who are doing forensic work are called judicial medical officers in the health ministry, and in the university system, they are called forensic pathologists. So we have two groups of doctors. In the universities, there are professors, associate professors, senior lecturers and lecturers, and also postgraduate trainees, that is doctors who are trained to become forensic pathologists. In the health department, these doctors are called usually judicial medical officers, and there are district medical officers in peripheral hospitals where there are no JMOs to do the medical legal work. Then there's a category called MO, medical legal, who are training as training to become forensic pathologists. And finally, health department also has postgraduate trainees. So these are the two categories in the university and as well as in the health department. Next slide, please. To enter the MD training program, as in all the other specialties, you have to wait for 1 year after the internship. The subjects you did or the specialties you did in the internship are immaterial. You have to sit for a screening test. MCQs are there 40, true and false, and also best of 5 MCQs. So here, the subjects covered are anatomy, psychiatry, cancer, basic pathology, forensic medicine, pharmacology, medicine, sudden death, etc. So it's like in other branches of postgraduate medicine, we cover a vast area in the screening test. Next slide, please. After passing the screening test, placement in a JMO office or a university department. So you have in the other unit. So you are covered in the university system as well as in the health department by doing 2 years in JMO's office and 1 year in the university department. Next slide, please. The assessment for the MD, 2 continuous assessments and 2 post-mortem examinations. And you should do research and make publications or dissertations and prepare a portfolio of the cases you do, and there will be a clinical examination case. This is how we assess you in the MD final examination in forensic medicine. Next slide, please. So the final examination will have MCQs, theory, SCQs, OSPI, VIVA, and clinical, long case and short cases. Next slide. Senior registrar training, once you pass your MD, is for 1 year. Then after that, you are sent to Bordeaux for in training. Again, 1 year. You may extend it to 2 years if you wish. Then we have special interest training, histopathology, toxicology, or anthropology. We already have. Forensic in histopathology, toxicology, and anthropology. Then you have to prepare a post-MD portfolio to get the board certification. Next slide, please. There is a new Master of Forensic Medicine exam. It is being drafted now. It's a one-year program, 1 year in-service training in a GM office or university. And again, for this selection is by 40 MCQs, true and false. This is being worked out at the moment by the PGIM. So if you refer the PGIM site, you may be able to get information once the Master of Forensic Medicine is formed or prepared by the PGIM. Next slide, please. So this is what I want to tell you. Remember, financially, there is no private practice as such, but all JMOs or university pathologists get 3,000 rupees per postmortem. So if you are in a unit where you can get certain number of postmortem, that will add to your salary. Then there is on-call system payment for the JMOs who work after hours, but there is no private practice as such. But I know some JMOs of the health ministry as well as in the university, they do private practice as general practitioners in their area, which is allowed and which can be done because that has no bearing on your forensic work. This is my email if you want to write to me, and my telephone number if you want to contact me to get further information. The forensic medicine is widely accepted by the doctors, and there are several ladies who are forensic pathologists in the health department as well as in the university system. I welcome you to join forensic medicine. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Ravindra, for that informative presentation. There's a question for you. Doctor is asking, do we need a law degree to become a forensic specialist?
No, we don't need a law degree, but it is useful if we have one. There are a couple of forensic pathologists in the university system who have done LLB, Bachelor of Laws, in the law college, and that is helpful in their interpretation of medical legal work, but it is not essential.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Then I want to pose another question. You talked about the opportunities available in the academic field, in the universities and in the health sector. Is there any opportunities in the private sector or corporate sector or internationally for forensic, to do forensic?
No, not at the moment, because in the forensic, either you have to do clinical forensic, that is examining injured people, or you have to do the post-mortem. So post-mortems are out because it has to be done at the request of the inquiry into sudden death or magistrate. So they will always refer to the health ministry or the universities. So there is no private work as such, except giving reports on cases. Now, there are certain cases where the lawyers wants to have a defense examination of the medical reports. So they send the reports to us and ask our opinion. That will help them when they cross-examine a witness or when they cross-examine a police officer. So in that way, the doctors at the highest level may get some private work from the lawyers.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Ravindra Fernando, for that informative session discussing that. Thank you for your time.